hospice and palliative medicine physician practicing at the University of California, San Francisco, considered a national thought leader on the end-of-life care. Her writing has appeared in several journals, including the New York Times, JAMA, Science and Annals of Internal Medicine, and her first book is nearing completion. Dr. Gross is the creator and host of the radio program Dying to Talk, the first of its kind program dedicated to transforming the taboo around talking about death. And she is a co-founder of the new communication consulting corporation called Dialogues. Dr. Gross earned her bachelor's from the University of Southern California and her MD and PhD from Tufts University School of Medicine. She has yet to be awarded her master's in parenting from her three children, and it is grateful beyond words to get to be celebrating her 25th wedding anniversary next month. What's your secret? So let me, ladies and gentlemen, let's call and give a warm applause with Dr. Don Ross.
And it was just before lunchtime. So think 30 minutes earlier to now, what you were feeling. And you could sense the anticipation in the boarding care as the staff, the caregivers were preparing to serve meals wherever people were situated, whether it was in their bed or in their chair in the living room or in the kitchen, wherever. But this woman in particular was starting to get very giddy. And her daughter shared with me, "You'll see why." And the first words that this woman spoke to me, my patient, were, just as her lunch was being served to her, "Life is uncertain. Better eat dessert first." And what the caregivers brought her
was not the same as they were providing to other residents. They brought her a bowl of ice cream. And her daughter really smiled and was quite joyful at the acknowledgement that the caregivers recognized how important this was to her mother and honored it by saying, "You can have dessert first." She died a week later. I shared this encounter with my children when I came home that first day of meeting her. I was blissfully happy. And my children immediately owned that. And I quickly realized maybe that wasn't the smartest thing I've done as a parent. But why I share this in reflection to the topic of grief and bereavement is this. This woman lives with me virtually every day of my life. She lives with my children. That we've created a cultural practice now in our family of honoring what matters most to us by that simple phrase. "Mom, life's uncertain. How about Ghirardelli tonight?" And it's not that they abuse it, but what they do is remind me. And what's critical, and what I hope you walk away with by the end of this presentation, and really it's an interactive process, so by your engagement, is creating permission to share what we miss so that we can keep it present with us, and that we can create a new way for what we miss to show up. And in so doing, we create legacy, and we create life. And we create new connections. And it doesn't make it better missing someone, missing what we lost, whether it's a job or a relationship or a human being or a cat or dog. It doesn't make it better in that I still miss her. And I am certain her daughter still misses her. And I'm certain the staff that helped care so uniquely for her, miss her. It gives us something to add to the missing so that the missing doesn't become a vacuum by itself. And that's what I hope to give each of you today, is permission to be able to talk about the things that matter to us and then to create something so that we don't get left only with what's missing. So with that, I will have to disclose, as you heard, that I started this company, and as an academic, we always have to disclose things, even though it has nothing to do with what we really will be talking about today, but you've been informed. Okay, so what are we going to talk about? Briefly, I'm going to give you perhaps a radical perspective on what I think caregiving is, very briefly. I'm going to go over some literature about how professional caregivers have been explored in their grief process. How do professionals grieve? And then I'm going to have us switch gears and look at the nuances of grief in caregiving, specifically in the context of dementia. And from there, that will immediately bring us to the importance of what's created in this room, which is community. And that, ultimately, all that happens really, really quickly, will set us up to then do an interactive activity together to experience grief in the context of community and what becomes available when we allow ourselves to do that. So while I brought materials that are on your table and I'll guide you when to reach for them, what I did not bring is a box of Kleenex, which I assumed actually would be on the table. And that's not to say you're required or expected to cry, but if you do, it's totally fine. It's welcome. If for any reason you feel that you just don't want to do this, you should also feel free to take a break and leave and come back whenever you want. Okay? Great. So here are my two cents on caregiving. This artwork that you're looking at is actually created, it's a small portion of a very large-scale installation by a dear friend and colleague of mine, someone who's responsible for actually creating this work that I'll be presenting in the workshop portion. Her name's Jennifer Kaufman, and she is an artist. She is a bereavement counselor, and she is a caregiver, and has intimate experience with dementia. And what I was inspired by was, this is a quote of her. She's also a poet, as I'll read this to you. This is her describing her artwork. So she loves to explore lines, as you can probably tell by her style of artistry. This is ink and black tape on paper. And what she says is, a piece of sturdy paper provides a place to encounter a line, to engage its impulse towards fragmentation and its inclination for infinity. And what struck me as I read that, and as I was thinking about this program, was, if I swap out just a couple of words, I'm actually talking about caregiving, and let me show you. If instead of a sturdy piece of paper, I replace caregiving as that foundation of where we can capture and support people, and I replace line with life, so that this sturdy caregiving is a place to support life, then it reads that life has an impulse toward fragmentation, which it does. And I know I said I wasn't going to talk about death, but when we talk about life, we invoke death by definition. So as we continue in our lives, we are, by definition, fragmenting. Whether it's in our minds or our bodies, at some point, we fragment. And it can be all of a sudden, or it can take a long, long time, but we fragment. And at the same time, we move toward infinity as we create impact and relationship and legacy. And caregiving becomes the landing pad for all of that to happen. So that's what all of you are doing, just so you know. You are holding this space of fragmentation, unavoidable, while simultaneously holding infinity. And that's pretty powerful stuff. So how do professionals grieve? In one capacity or another, I suspect everyone in this room has self-identified as a professional caregiver as well as perhaps a non-professional, although honestly, we could break that down in a whole nother talk. So how do professionals grieve? Meaning, if I am charged with, as my professional role, in my case, I'm a physician, to care for someone who in my culture we call a patient, how am I allowed to express my experience of loss, whether it's because they die or because they move away or I move away? How am I allowed to express that separation of a relationship? A group a few years ago, led by Lee Granick and her team, asked specifically a cohort of physicians, oncologists, so cancer doctors, and they asked, what's it like for you to professionally express your grief? And here are some of the words that they shared. You've already heard this word a lot today. We can't even talk about dementia. Doctors can't even tell the people that have given them the honor of learning about them. They can't even tell them what they found, because it's a stigma. It's a sign of weakness. Professionals actually believe that if they share that they cared about someone and that it's upsetting to them, they are weak. They are unprofessional. I mean, think about that. Health care. The word care is in there. Care giving. Care is in there. And yet, if I tell you and I show you I care, I'm now unprofessional, even though my professional work includes the word care. And they argued that, well, we exist inside a context where the expectation is cure. So anything that doesn't achieve cure is failure, and I don't want to acknowledge that. So there's no room to acknowledge loss, specifically death, because that would imply I failed, since all I'm supposed to do is cure. And yet, last time I checked, Google had not found a cure for mortality. We are all mortal. So how is it any of us expect to have 100% cure rate in a lifetime? That's not going to happen. Yet we've pretzelized ourselves as professionals. We've not given ourselves a space to acknowledge the reality of our mortality. So as a result, we have no permission to grieve publicly as professionals. And what happens in academics, certainly, is without permission to do something, you're not going to get training to do something. And then you have that vicious circle. Well, if you haven't been taught how to do it, then you're not going to ever do it. And so none of this happens. And as a result, we have an epidemic of burnout. As professionals, unprecedented levels of suicide happening in the culture of medicine. And here are some of the phrases the doctors themselves said about when they think about professional grief. They say, it keeps me awake at night. Yeah, that's going to lead to burnout. You become accustomed to it. Really? You know, I am not accustomed to grieving like it's no big deal. It pretty much rocks my world. It's very bad to become attached to your patients because they're going to die, is what one doctor was implying. So, and you're going to suffer. You don't want to put yourself in that position. So the solution, better just disassociate. And I come back to the fact that the word care is embedded in healthcare, is embedded in caregiving, in being a caregiver. And yet the solution isn't how do we express our grief? It's let's just shut down entirely. As I said, we have an epidemic of burnout, catastrophic. So I'm going to give you an alternative. Now, moving specifically toward what grief experiences like in the context of dementia is even more complex. So there's a term, anticipatory grief. When we anticipate that someone's going to die, there's no timeline of when anticipatory grief sets in, if you will, like when does someone begin dying. That's a really hard thing to say. I could tell you I'm dying right now because I am. I'm mortal. Do I think I'm going to die in the next 10 minutes? I hope for your sake not. But, right? It's a fuzzy matter. We can get clarity, certainly, as people are actively dying. Hopefully, I'm not so actively dying. But anticipatory grief is a moving target. With dementia, there are layers to it. There's the grief of anticipating someone's going to die with or because of this diagnosis. And there are pieces of people that we lose along the way uniquely related to this illness. So while some illnesses, chronic illnesses, we can anticipate people will start to lose certain independent capabilities, there are some unique aspects to dementia that make grief experiences and the possibility of finding our way in healing with grief much more challenging. And that's directly related to this term that's been created, not by me, but by Bladen's group, of dementia grief. So they attribute this definition of a unique form of anticipatory grief in the context of dementia, in that you not only are you having these serial losses of independent functioning loss, that it's relatively ambiguous and fluctuating. It's a moving target. One day mom recognizes me, the next day she doesn't. One day my patient can get here on their own, the next day they can't. But here's the real key, and this is what's particularly challenging when we reflect on how we navigate grief. And that's with dementia uniquely, we lose our sense of self. We lose our sense of place and time and who we are and who we're related to and how we're related in the world. And one of the most important things of grief, as I'll get to in a minute, is that it is by definition relational. And when you start to lose the ability to relate, the ability to navigate grief becomes extra compromised. So, these disruptions that happen with this loss of communication that's inherent to progressive dementia, this loss of self-awareness, interrupts our ability to create resolution, to come to terms with our grief. You know, one of the things Hollywood does in many movies is it shows you these sort of epiphanal transformations with people as they're on their deathbed, because they can finally come to terms with that family member who they stopped talking with 20 years ago or something of that sort. And while that happens in reality at times, mostly what happens is the really hard work of getting comfortable with being uncomfortable, of learning how to come towards what's hard, which is what all of you do as caregivers. You go where other people are uncomfortable, and you get really close. And then we have to wrestle with that and navigate that and figure out what to do with that. When we lose the ability to talk with people, that gets interrupted. So how do we find a path to healing? One of the keys is to be able to acknowledge we're experiencing loss, whether it's anticipatory or after we have lost the relationship, bereavement. We have to be able to acknowledge it. Ideally, we're able to acknowledge it in the anticipatory state with the person, the relationship that's at risk. But often we can't. And particularly, as I said, with dementia, we lose that ability. Now, here's something interesting that happened in a medical community in Michigan, where they created this whole platform to draw attention to grief awareness for professionals, which is all fantastic. That is a beginning. But again, in dementia, we start to lose that ability because we start to lose the ability to actually communicate and share what we're losing. As I said, the ability to tolerate difficult feelings then becomes interrupted because that person, that relationship you would be navigating with, is suddenly not able to be there with you in communication and in understanding. So this is one of my favorite movies. I realized Pauline didn't know it. I was sending her an email and referencing this. Does everyone know here? Anyone know Inside Out? Yeah, this. If you don't know it, I highly recommend. This is all about emotions and what's on the inside and what we put out in the world. And this is a depiction of the character who represents the emotion sadness, which is actually my favorite. But why I love sadness is because it's actually such a powerful emotion in that it connects you directly to the things that really matter most to you. You can't grieve what you don't love. And so much of this movie ultimately moves people into recognizing that sadness points to grief more sharply than just about anything. And in the moment that sadness is allowed, instead of constantly shunned and pushed aside or kept into her tiny little circle and not allowed to leave, when she's actually allowed to be fully self-expressed, what happens is healing like no other emotion is capable of. And so this leads to adaptation, not closure. Please don't let anyone ever tell you to get over it, to move beyond it. Aren't you done yet? That was a while ago. Grief does not go away. It changes. It absolutely changes. It doesn't go away. We adapt. We create new relationships with it. We can even grow from it. But it doesn't go away. And here's the key to allowing that healing process to engage. It actually lives inside of community. So as I said, grief by definition is relational. And that is actually the title of a paper of one of my dearest friends, Dr. Harvey Peskin, who's a clinical psychologist. And on his deathbed, quite literally, this was the last paper that he wrote and published. And he was exploring what it is about grief. And inside of community, how there seems to be permission granted to certain relationships and permission denied to others. So again, professional grief, denied. You as a professional, not allowed to grieve in relationship to the person you're offering caregiving support to. Immediate family members, that inner circle, maybe there's this pecking order to grief. And so one of the oldest quotes around it is, never cry louder than the widow. You know, what if the widow offed him? Like what, I mean, she's probably, you know, dancing to the bank, but the children might want to cry. But this is suggesting this pecking order. Is that real? Is that completely made up? And what is the importance of it? And so what Harvey was saying is, by definition, as you've heard me say, grief is relational. It's relationship dependent. You can't grieve what you don't love. And it's influenced by those who witness, by community. And why that witnessing is so important is it validates that you cared when that person, that relationship is no longer able to be there to validate the importance it has been to you. That community then becomes the validation. So, this is Harvey. So with that background, we're now going to move into some direct workshop activity, if you are so willing. And this is where these materials come in. So on your table, you were each distributed just a pile of papers. So they could have patterns on them, or they could be solid. They all have white on the back. What I want to make sure everyone does is you take two different colored pieces of paper. They can be pattern or solid, it doesn't matter. But just make sure they're two different ones so you can distinguish them. And make sure you have something to write with. If anyone doesn't have paper or doesn't have a pen, raise your hand and we'll make sure you get them. All right? This shouldn't take long and it shouldn't... This isn't the activity, so don't get all excited yet. Okay. As soon as everyone has two colored pieces of paper, I'm going to just ask you to breathe for a minute. Just take a collective communal... You can sigh, you can have that happen, sure. You can stretch. We're just going to breathe. We're going to let this in. And as you do that, I want you to start thinking about a relationship that you're grieving. It could be anticipatory. It could be bereavement. The relationship could have already transformed. And I want you to hold that. Hold that in your mind. Get close to it, because I'm going to ask you to speak to it, okay? So breathe as you come up with that relationship. And here's the first thing I'm going to ask you to do. You're going to just pick one of your pieces of paper, just one of them. And you, depending on which type of color you selected, you may naturally just want to write on the white side of the page, because it might be hard to read if you have a dark piece of paper. But if you have a light piece of paper and you're so inspired, feel free. There's no right or wrong there. But I'm going to ask you to write a letter on one piece of paper. And here's the prompt. And I'll keep track of time. I'll give you a 30-second warning when it's time to sort of wrap up that thought. We'll have about 3 minutes or so. I want you to start with this. As you're thinking about this person and this relationship, I hope that you are. And given that we're at a conference specifically addressing Alzheimer's dementia, I invite you, if it's appropriate, to be thinking about a person with dementia, either now that you're in relationship with them or that you've had a relationship with. And what would you say to them, whether they're living or they have since died? What could you say to them right now? I hope that you are. Okay? Any questions about that before I start the timer? No? Ready? Okay. Just trust yourself. Just put your pen to the paper and write. There's nothing wrong that can happen. Okay? So you have about 3 minutes. Go. All right, see if you can put a period or a comma, or you can leave it as a fragment, it's fine. Keep breathing. And now I'm gonna invite you to find a partner in just a moment. Before we do that, I'm gonna set the ground rules here. So I'm gonna invite each of us to read what we wrote. So first and foremost, just know that whatever spoken in this room, whatever shared stays in this room, we can all honor that. That when it's your turn to read, that what I invite you to do is to read exactly what's on the page. You don't need a preamble, you don't need an explanation, no one needs to understand the context or the who's or the whys or the whats. No one needs to know. You just look at your paper and you read your words. And when you're the one listening, your job is to listen. You don't need to offer feedback. The power of listening deeply comes when we are intimate and silent. So don't interrupt. Don't comment. Be. Any questions? So I will also give you time. You'll have about 2 minutes each. I'll tell you when it's time to switch. So when you have been reading, I'll say switch. That means then it will be time for you to listen and the other person to read. What was that? No, it's all good. Okay. So we'll make sure, first of all, look and see if you have a partner nearby. If you don't have a partner, raise your hand. We want to make sure everyone has a partner. Can you find a partner? Do you have a partner? Do we need threesomes? Do you want a partner here? I think here. Okay, I think you guys have started. Hold on a second. Hold on. Okay, everyone have a partner? Anyone without a partner? All right, I'm going to time you. All right, the person with the most hair goes first. All right, begin. All right, try and finish up. Does anyone need more time? Did everyone get a chance to read? Everyone get a chance to listen? All right. We pause the conversation. Come back. I hear a lot of emotions. It's wonderful. See, you're being inside out right here, right now. It's good. Thank you. Okay, that's just part one. We got three more parts to get through. Come back. Okay, moving on. All right. You're going to take your other piece of paper. So whichever one you didn't write on, get your other color. You're going to write a reply. Ooh. So here's the prompt. Here's the prompt. Again, if you have written to someone who has or has experienced dementia, then I invite you in your response to imagine how they would respond to what you wrote to them in the absence of dementia. So if you knew them before the dementia developed, you have a reference point, but sometimes as professional caregivers, we don't have that luxury, we don't have that pleasure. So I invite you to imagine in that case who you think they are all the way, through and through, and how they would respond to what you wrote them. That's the way I'd like you to write your reply on their behalf. What, in their words, would they say to you? Any questions about that? You understand that? Okay, same amount of time. Go, pencil, pen down. Right, see if you can make your way to a comma or a period. I think you might be able to guess what's coming. I'm going to invite you to turn to your partner again. Same ground rules, same opportunity. Read what you wrote. Listen deeply. I'll give you the time to switch. In this case, whoever got up the earliest goes first. Go. How are we doing? You guys hanging in there? We have two more stages. Come on. All right, it's about to get hard. It's about to get hard. Are you guys ready for that? I think you're up to it, but it's about to get hard. All right, part three. We're now going to do what dementia does, which is it comes unrequested, undesired, and it takes from that which we hold dearest. So I'm going to ask you to give your partner your pages, and I'm going to ask your partner to give them to you. So swap pages. And your job is to fragment those pages. Tear them up. Yeah. Yeah. Why? Yeah, I hear why. No, exactly. Exactly. Alzheimer's doesn't get to answer our why. And it really doesn't listen to our no, not yet anyway. It doesn't care. So just notice what that feels like. I'm hearing you sharing with each other. You know, notice what that feels like. And very quickly, for time's sake, we're going to move to part four. As you're noticing this, as you're observing this, here's the opportunity. There's also tape on the table. Different kinds of tape. I invite you to either work with your own letters, work with your partners, however you choose, and you're going to create new connections. You can use the tape to create however you wish the letters to integrate to each other, to integrate to your partner's letters or not. It's however you imagine. Create something new with what you've lost. All right? So go ahead, use your tape. Use your letters. You can layer them. You can weave them. Create something new. You have about 3 minutes. All right. I'm going to pause wherever you have taped or woven or what have you. Just pause right there so we can finish up for the time being. We have other amazing presentations coming. The opportunity to share, I hope that you will take the opportunity to share with each other well beyond this moment, that you will take this back to your own communities, to your family, and that some of the things I hope you've observed. We don't have time so much for me to hear directly from you, although I'll give you my emails and a Twitter. If you would be so generous, if you're inspired, to take photos of what you created or share a comment of what it was like to write or to hear the response or to tear or watch your letter be torn and to recreate, I would love to hear that from you. The opportunity, though, that I hope you recognize is that you gave each other permission to talk about your sadness, your loss, your grief. And you're still here, right? Nobody burst into flames and nobody got fired and nobody's been told they're unprofessional, right? Nobody did that. That instead, I hope what you've experienced is a sense of community, of true human connection, that this is what we can do for each other always. That while our grief is communal, it's dependent on each other, it is always uniquely our own. But we need to share it so that we can keep doing the work that we are so inspired to do. We can't afford to lose any of you. So I hope that you have experienced one example of creating permission to share grief. So here's some examples. This was actually mine from a little while ago, but some other people who've done this work with me, just some of the things that they created. So to complete, just in Harvey's words, that the self is injured when one's right to grieve is withheld, overlooked, or otherwise curtailed. You have the power to give the people in your life, to give yourself permission to grieve. It is the breath of the work that we do. If you hold your breath, you know what will happen. So please keep caring, keep breathing, keep grieving. And with that, I really thank you for participating. Please send questions. Thank you.